आई अंजलि बंसल, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी, इज गिविंग प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन द टॉपिक सेपरेशन ऑफ पावर्स. The term separation of powers was coined by a French jurist Montesquieu in his book El Spirit des Lois, meaning thereby spirit of laws, published in 1748. The doctrine of separation of powers deals with the mutual relations among the three organs of the government, namely legislature, executive and judicial. According to Montesquieu, there can be no liberty if the legislative and executive powers are amalgamated in the same person or body, or judicial power is not separated from the legislative and executive power. The integration of judicial and legislative power would expose the life and liberty of the subject to arbitrary control, as judge would then be the legislature. Judges might behave with violence and oppression if judiciary is merged with the executive. The position of this doctrine has to be studied vis-a-vis United Kingdom, United States of America and India. Doctrine of separation of powers in UK. There are three different organs operating in England, that is Parliament, King and the courts. Parliament is having lawmaking powers, King is the executive head and courts are having judicial powers. The definition given by Wade and Phillips relating to separation of power is having three features. First, the same person should not form more than part of one organ. One organ of the government should not exercise the function of the other organs of the government. And thirdly, one organ of the government should not encroach with the function of the other two organs of the government. Applicability of this doctrine in England. The king, being the executive head, is also an integral part of the legislature. His ministers are also members of one or other houses of parliament. This concept goes against the idea that same person should not form part of more than one organ of the government. The House of Commons control the executive. So far as judiciary is concerned, in theory, House of Lords is the highest court of the country, but in practice, judicial functions are discharged by specially appointed lords and other lords who held judicial post. Thus, we can say that doctrine of separation of powers is not applicable to Britain in strict sense. Now, doctrine of separation of powers in USA. In USA, there are three different organs operating, that is Congress, second President and third Supreme Court. The legislative branch is ruled by the Congress, who makes the law. The executive branch, in executive branch, the President enforces the law, and in judicial branch, Supreme Court interprets the law. The definition given by Madison relating to separation of power is the accumulation of all parts, legislative, executive and judicial, in the same hands, whether of one, a few or many, and whether hereditary, self-appointed or elective, may justly be pronounced the very definition of tyranny. System of checks and balance in USA. The President of the United States interferes with the exercise of powers by the Congress through the exercise of his veto power. He also exercises the law-making power in exercise of his treaty-making power. He also interferes with the functioning of the Supreme Court through the exercise of his power to appoint judges. In the same manner, Congress interferes with the power of the President through vote on budget, approval of appointments by the Senate, and the ratification of treaty. It also interferes with the exercise of powers by the courts by passing procedural laws, creating special courts, and by approving the appointment of judges. In its turn, judiciary interferes with the powers of the Congress and the president through the exercise of the power of the judicial review. Doctrine of separation of powers in India. This doctrine has four aspects. First, different organs operating in India. There is a federal system of government in India in which there is a division of power between the center and the state. The organs operating at center or union level is legislature, executive and judicial, where legislature is controlled by parliament, executive by president and judiciary by the Supreme Court. At state level, legislative functions are performed by state legislative assembly and state legislative council, executive by governor and judicial functions by the High Court. Separation of powers in India. The three powers are separated under constitution, that is executive powers, legislative power and judicial powers. The executive powers in India has to be dealt with under three aspects. First, scope of executive powers. Under scope of executive powers, the powers relating to union and the state has been studied differently. According to Article 52 provides, there shall be a President of India. Article 53 Clause 1 declares the President to be the head of the Union Executive. It provides that the executive power of the Union shall be vested in the President and shall be exercised by him either directly or through officers subordinate to him. In the same manner, Article 153 provides that there shall be a governor for each state. Article 154 Clause 1 provides that the executive power of the state shall be vested in the governor and shall be exercised by him either directly or through officers subordinate to him in accordance with this constitution. Then the executive power, extent of executive power has been dealt with under Article 73 Clause 1 in respect of union and Article 162 in respect of state. Article 73 Clause 1 provides that the executive power of the union extends to the matters with respect to which parliament has power to make laws. The executive power of the union does not extend to a matter enumerated in the concurrent list of the 7th schedule unless expressly provided in the constitution. In the same manner, Article 162 deals with the extent of executive power of the state and it states that subject to the provisions of this constitution, the executive power of a state shall extend to the matters with respect to which the legislature of the state has power to make laws. Third, conduct of business of the government of India and the state. Article 77 requires that every executive action of the union shall be expressed to be taken in the name of the president, and in the same manner, Article 166 of the constitution provides that all executive action of the government of a state shall be expressed to be taken in the name of the governor. Fourth, president or governor not to be a member of either parliament or state legislature. Article 59 Clause 1 provides that president shall not be a member of either house of parliament or of a house of the legislature of any state, and if a member of either house of parliament or of a house of the legislature of any state be elected president, he shall be deemed to have vacated his seat in that house on the date on which he enters upon his office as president. In the same manner, Article 158 Clause 1 provides that the governor shall not be a member of either house of parliament or of a house of the legislature of any state specified in the first schedule, and if a member of either house of parliament or of a house of a legislature of any such state be appointed governor, he shall be deemed to have vacated his seat in that house on the date on which he enters upon his office as governor. Fifth, power of president to consult Supreme Court. Article 143 Clause 1 provides that if it appears to the president that a question of law or fact has arisen or is likely to arise which is of such a nature and of such public importance that it is expedient to obtain the opinion of the Supreme Court upon it, he may refer the question to that court for consideration, and the court may, after such hearing as it thinks fit, report to the President its opinion thereon. Sixth, competent to frame rules regarding condition of the service. Article 309 provides that President is competent to make rules regulating the recruitment and the conditions of service of the persons appointed to such services and posts in connection with the affairs of the Union until provisions in that behalf is made by or under an act of the appropriate legislature. In the same manner, Governor is competent to make rules appointing, regulating the recruitment and the conditions of the service of persons to such services and posts in connection with the affairs of the state until provision in that behalf is made by or under an act of the appropriate legislature. Then, executive powers in India and its interference in the legislative powers. First, executive is a part of legislature also. Article 79 provides that the Union Parliament shall consist of the President and two houses known as the Council of the State and the House of the People. He nominates 12 persons eminent in literature, art, science or social service to the Rajya Sabha. He may also nominate 2 persons belonging to Anglo-Indian community to the Lok Sabha. In the same manner, Article 168 provides that state legislature shall consist of the governor, and where there are 2 houses of the legislature of a state, one shall be known as the legislative council and the other as the legislative assembly, and where there is only 1 house, it shall be known as the legislative assembly. The governor of a state may nominate 1 member of that community to the assembly if he is of the opinion that the Anglo-Indian community is not adequately represented therein. Second, power to summon, prorogue and dissolve. It is the President who is vested with the power to summon the sessions of the Houses of Parliament. The time and place of holding the session is to be determined by him. Again, it is the President who has the power to prorogue the session of House of the People. The President may dissolve Lok Sabha before the expiry of its term of 5 years. In the same manner, Article 174, Clause 1 states that the Governor shall from time to time summon the House or each House of the Legislature of the State to meet at such time and place as he thinks fit, but 6 months shall not intervene between its last meeting in one session and the date appointed for its first meeting in the next session. Article 174, Clause 2 provides that the Governor may from time to time prorogue the House or either House dissolve the Legislative Assembly. Third, power to address the Houses. The President may address either House of Parliament or both Houses assembled together, and for that purpose, he may require the attendance of the members. He may send message to either House of the Parliament with respect to a bill then pending in the House. The President addresses both House of Parliament assembled together after general election and at the commencement of the first session of each year. In the same manner, Article 175 provides that the Governor may address the Legislative Assembly or, in a case of a state having a Legislative Council, either House of the Legislature of the state or both Houses assembled together, and for that purpose he may require the attendance of members. He may send messages to the House or Houses of the Legislature of the state with respect to a pending bill. The Governor shall address the Legislative Assembly or, in the case of a state having a Legislative Council, both Houses assemble together after general election and at the commencement of the first session of each year. Interference in the legislative procedure. Every bill passed by both the Houses of Parliament is sent to the President for his assent and becomes the act only when it is assented to by him. He may give his assent or withhold it. Every year, the President causes to be laid before both the Houses of Parliament the annual financial statement. In similar manner, every bill passed by the Legislative Assembly of a state, or in the case of a state having a legislative council, has been passed by both houses of the legislature of the state, is presented to the governor for his assent. He may give his assent or withhold it. Article 202, clause 1, states that the governor shall, in respect of every financial year, cause to be laid before the house or houses of the legislature of the state a statement of the estimated receipts and expenditure of the state for that year, that is, annual financial statement. Fifth, decision on questions as to disqualification of members. If any question arises as to disqualification of a member of either House of Parliament, then the question shall be referred for the decision of the President, and his decision shall be final. In the same manner, if any question arises as to disqualification of a member of a house of the legislature of the state, then the question shall be referred for the decision of the governor, and his decision shall be final. Then, sixth, appointment of Prime Minister, Chief Minister and other ministers. Article 75, clause 1 provides that Prime Minister shall be appointed by the President, and the other ministers shall be appointed by the President on the advice of the Prime Minister. The ministers shall hold office during the pleasure of the President. In the same manner, Article 164, clause 1 provides that the Chief Minister shall be appointed by the Governor, and the other ministers shall be appointed by the Governor on the advice of the Chief Minister, and the ministers shall hold office during the pleasure of the Governor. Then, last, duty to furnish information to the Executive. Duty has been imposed on the Prime Minister to communicate to the President all decisions of the Council of the Ministers relating to the administration of the affairs of the Union and the proposals for legislation. In the same manner, Article 161 states that it shall be the duty of the Chief Minister of each state to communicate to the Governor of the state all decisions of the Council of the Ministers relating to the administration of the affairs of the state and proposals for legislation. Then, ordinance making power with the Executive. When both the Houses of the Parliament are not in session and the President is satisfied that circumstances exist which necessitates taking of immediate action, then he may promulgate ordinance. It shall have the same force and same effect as an Act of Parliament, but every such ordinance shall be laid before both Houses of Parliament. It shall cease to operate at the expiration of 6 weeks from the reassembly of Parliament, or before the expiration of that period, resolution disapproving it are passed by both houses. In the same manner, when the Legislative Assembly of a state is not in session, or where there is a Legislative Council in a state, except when both the houses of the legislature are in session, the Governor is satisfied that circumstances exist which render it necessary for him to take immediate action, then it shall have the same force and effect as an Act of the legislature of the state assented to by the Governor. It shall cease to operate at the expiration of 6 weeks from the reassembly of the legislature, or if before the expiration of that period a resolution disapproving it is passed by the Legislative Assembly. Then, powers in relation to emergency. Article 356 confers power on the President to issue a proclamation declaring that the government in a state cannot be carried on in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution. Parliament may confer on the President the power of the legislature of the state to make laws. Then, executive powers in India and its interference of executive in judicial powers. There are three aspects of this area. First, power to grant pardon vested in the executive. Article 72 provides that the president shall have the power to grant pardons, reprieves, respites or remissions of punishment, or to suspend, remit or commute the sentence of any person convicted of any offence in all cases where the punishment or sentence is by a court-martial, where the punishment or sentence is for an offence against any law relating to a matter to which the executive power of the union extends, and where the sentence is a sentence of death. In the similar manner, Article 161 provides that the governor of a state shall have the power to grant pardons, reprieves, respites or remissions of punishment, or to suspend, remit or commute the sentence of any person convicted of any offence against any law relating to a matter to which the executive power of the state extends. Secondly, immunity to executive under Article 361. Article 361 provides that the president shall not be answerable to any court for the exercise and performance of the powers and duties of his office, or for any act done or purporting to be done by him in the exercise and performance of those powers and duties. No criminal proceedings whatsoever shall be instituted or continued against the president in any court during his term of office. No process for the arrest or imprisonment of the president shall be issued from any court during his term of office, and the same immunity has been conferred on the governor under the same article, that is Article 361. Thirdly, role of executive in appointment of judges. Article 124 clause 2 states that every judge of the Supreme Court shall be appointed by the president by warrant under his hand and seal after consultation with such of the judges of the Supreme Court and of the high courts in the states as the president may deem necessary for the purpose. In the same manner, every judge of a high court is appointed by the president by warrant under his hand and seal after consultation with the Chief Justice of India, the governor of the state, and in the case of appointment of a judge other than the Chief Justice, the Chief Justice of the High Court. Then, the legislative powers in India. Legislative powers in India has three dimensions. First, scope of legislative powers in India. Composition. Article 79 provides that there shall be a parliament for the union, which shall consist of the president and two houses to be known as respectively as the Council of the States and the House of the People. In the same manner, Article 168 provides for constitution of legislature in states. For every state, there shall be a legislature which shall consist of the governor, and in the states of Bihar, Maharashtra, Karnataka and Uttar Pradesh, two houses, and in other state, one house. Where there are two houses of the legislature of a state, one shall be known as the Legislative Council and the other as the Legislative Assembly. And where there is only one house, it shall be known as the Legislative Assembly. Functions under Article 245 and 246. Parliament has exclusive power to legislate on matters enumerated in List 1, that is Union List. Article 248 states that Parliament has exclusive power to make any law with respect to any matter not enumerated in the concurrent list or the state list. In the same manner, the legislature of the state has exclusive power to legislate on matters enumerated in List 2, that is state list. Both Parliament as well as state legislature can legislate on matters enumerated in List 3, that is concurrent list. Framing rules of procedure. Each House of Parliament may make rules for regulating its procedure and the conduct of its business subject to the provisions of the Constitution, and in the same manner, the legislature of a state may make rules for regulating its procedure and the conduct of its business subject to the provisions of the Constitution. The second aspect of legislative powers in India is the interference of legislature in executive. Then, first, role in election of president. Article 54 provides that the president shall be elected by the members of an electoral college consisting of the elected members of both houses of parliament and the elected members of the legislative assemblies of the state. Impeachment proceedings against president carried on by the parliament. An impeachment is a quasi-judicial procedure in parliament. Either house may prefer the charge of violation of the constitution before the other house, which shall then either investigate the charge itself or cause the charge to be investigated. But the charge cannot be preferred by a house unless a resolution containing the proposal is moved after a 14 days notice in writing, signed by not less than 1/4 of the total number of members of that house, and the resolution is then passed by a majority of not less than 2/3 of the total membership of the house. Council of Ministers to aid and advise President. Article 74 clause 1 provides that there shall be a Council of Ministers with the Prime Minister at the head to aid and advise the President, who shall in exercise of his function act in accordance with such advice. In the similar provision of Council of Ministers to aid and advise the Governor has been made under Article 163. The third aspect of legislative powers in India is relating to interference of legislature in judiciary. Firstly, courts should not to inquire into proceedings of Parliament or legislature. Article 122 provides that the court shall not call validity of any proceedings in Parliament in question on the ground of any alleged irregularity of procedure. Similarly, Article 212 provides that the court should not inquire into the proceedings of the legislature. Then, parliamentary privileges under Article 105 and 194. Privileges are those rights without which it would be impossible for either house to maintain its independence of action or the dignity of its position. They may be divided into two groups. Firstly, those which are enjoyed by the members individually, and secondly, those belonging to each house of the parliament as a collective body. The privilege of the house collectively are, first, the right to publish debates and proceedings and the right to restrain publication by others. Secondly, the right to exclude others. Third, right to regulate the internal affairs of the house. Fourthly, the right to publish parliamentary proceedings. Fifth, right to punish members and outsiders for breach of its privileges. In P.V. Narasimha Rao versus State, it was observed that it is not enough that members should be protected against civil action and criminal proceedings, the cause of action of which is their speech or vote. To enable the members to participate fearlessly in parliamentary debates, members need the wider protection of immunity against all civil and criminal proceedings that bear a nexus to their speech or vote. But the trend has been changed. In Raja Rampal versus Honorable Speaker Lok Sabha, the court held that even if Parliament had only the limited remedial power to punish for contempt, the power to expel would be well within the limits of such remedial contempt power. In Manohar Lal Sharma versus Principal Secretary, the Supreme Court held that for successful working of democracy, it is essential that public revenue are not defrauded and public servants do not indulge in bribery and corruption, and if they do, such allegations should be inquired into fairly, properly and promptly, and those who are guilty are brought to book. Then thirdly, adjudication of water disputes. Article 262 provides that Parliament may by law provide for the adjudication of any dispute to the use, distribution or control of the waters of or in any interstate river or river valley, and notwithstanding anything in this constitution, Parliament may by law provide that neither the Supreme Court nor any other court shall exercise jurisdiction in respect of any such dispute or complaints. The Supreme Court refused to interfere in the policy adopted by the state for allocation of water from Sardar Sarovar project to the district of Kutch. It can interfere only if policy is inconsistent with the constitutional laws or arbitrary or irrational, and it was held in Kutch Jal Sankat Nivaran Samiti versus State of Gujarat. Then, fourthly, role of legislature in removal of judges. A judge of the Supreme Court may be removed by an order of the President on ground of proved misbehavior or incapacity. The order of the President can only be passed after he has been addressed to by both houses by a majority of total membership of that house and also by a majority of not less than 2/3 of a members present and voting. Then, separation of powers in India and third organs, that is judicial powers in India. Judicial powers in India has to be studied from three dimensions. The first is scope of judicial powers in India. Article 13 makes fundamental rights enforceable in the courts. It declares that a law which is inconsistent with the fundamental rights is void, whether that law is pre-constitutional or post-constitutional. This power of judicial review is exercised by the Supreme Court and the High Court under Article 32 and 226 respectively. The courts can declare a law unconstitutional if it is inconsistent with the fundamental rights. The second aspect is interference of judiciary in executive. First, interference of judiciary in executive powers relating to clemency powers, Article 72 and 161. In Devender Pal Singh Bhullar versus State of NCT of Delhi and Shatrughan Chauhan versus Union of India, the Supreme Court held that the power vested in the President under Article 72 and the Governor under Article 161 of the Constitution is manifestation of the prerogative of the state. It is neither a matter of grace nor a matter of privilege, but is an important constitutional responsibility to be discharged by the highest executive, keeping in view the consideration of larger public interest and welfare of people. The said power has to be exercised with the aid of justice and not in defiance of it. Though no words of limitation are indicated in these articles, but the said power is subject to limited judicial review on the ground of unfair, unjust and unreasonable procedure of disposal of mercy petition. Secondly, interference in ordinance making power of the executive. In A.K. Roy versus Union of India, the Supreme Court held that the ordinance making power of the President would be subject to the tests of vagueness, arbitrariness, reasonableness, public interest, and that it was passed during the recess of the Union Parliament. In D.C. Wadhwa versus State of Bihar, it was brought to the notice of the court that between 1967 and 1980 in the State of Bihar, 256 ordinances were promulgated, and all these were kept alive for periods ranging from 1 year to 14 years by promulgation, re-promulgation from time to time. The Supreme Court struck down this exercise of the ordinance-making power as a subversion of the democratic process and colorable exercise of power. The court held that such exercise of power amounted to a fraud upon the Constitution and hence unconstitutional. The court observed that the executive could not usurp the functions assigned to the legislature under the Constitution. Then, last aspect is the interference of judiciary in legislature. Power to regulate its proceedings under Article 145 and 227 Clause 2 Clause P. The Supreme Court can make rules for the regulating generally the practice and procedure of the court, including rules as to the persons practicing before the court, rules as to the procedure for hearing appeals and other matters pertaining to appeals, including the time within which appeals to the court are to be entered. Even the High Court may make and issue general rules and prescribe forms of regulating the practice and proceedings of such court. Conclusion: there is no enunciated demarcation beyond which each of these organs cannot cross. What is most expected out of each of them is that they consciously realize the unseen boundaries and respect each other's sovereignty. This realization would help in upholding the rights of the citizens and establishing a welfare state. It is important to value the efforts of the framers of our constitution, who envisaged the nation's future as a harmonious relationship between the pillars of the government. It is not only the duty of the tripartite to realize the same, but also the obligation of the citizens to realize the ultimate sanctity of the constitution. Thank you.